Who wrote the book of Hebrews? When you consider the comprehensive agreement among biblical scholars about who wrote every other book of the New Testament, it's a little mysterious that we don't know who wrote Hebrews. There are a handful of contenders. Let's look at the reasons each of them might be the author. Did Paul write Hebrews? It is possible Paul wrote the book of Hebrews. There are a couple of reasons why this might be the case. First, in the earliest manuscript editions of the New Testament books, Hebrews is included after Romans among the books written by the Apostle Paul. This was taken as evidence that Paul had written it, and some Eastern churches accepted Hebrews as canonical earlier than in the West. Second, Clement of Alexandria, c. AD 150-215, and Origen, AD 185-253, claimed a Pauline association for the book but recognized that Paul himself probably did not put pen to paper for this book even though they did not know the author's name. Clement of Alexandria suggests that Paul wrote the book initially in Hebrew and that Luke translated it into Greek. However, the Greek of Hebrews bears no resemblance to translation Greek, e.g., that of the Septuagint. The King James Version assumes Pauline authorship. The nuanced position on the authorship question by the Alexandrian fathers was obscured by later church tradition that mistook Pauline association for Pauline authorship. The enormously influential King James Bible took its cue from this tradition. In fact, in the KJV, you'll find the title translated as it was found in some manuscripts, the Epistle of Paul the Apostle to the Hebrews. The tradition of Pauline authorship continued. Parallels between Hebrews and Paul's writings. It's certainly reasonable to conclude Paul wrote the book of Hebrews. Many of the thoughts of Hebrews are similar to those found in Paul's writings. Hebrews. Paul's writings. Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3, the sun is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. Colossians chapter 1 verses 15-17, the sun is the image of the invisible God, for in him all things were created. And in him, all things hold together. Hebrews chapter 2 verse 4, God also testified to it by signs, wonders, and various miracles, and by gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to his will. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 verse 11, all these are the work of the same Spirit, and he distributes them to each one, just as he determines. Hebrews chapter 2 verse 14-17. Since the children have flesh and blood, he too shared in their humanity so that by his death he might break the power of him who holds the power of death. ... Philippians chapter 2 verses 7-8, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a human being, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Hebrews chapter 8 verse 6, but in fact, the ministry Jesus has received is as superior to theirs as the covenant of which he is mediator is superior to the old one since the new covenant is established on better promises. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 6, he has made us competent as ministers of a new covenant, not of the letter but the Spirit, for the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. Hebrews chapter 10 verse 14, for by one sacrifice, he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. Romans chapter 5 verse 9, 12-1, since we have now been justified by his blood, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. The soteriology of Hebrews is relatively consistent with Paul's teaching. For instance, the statement in Hebrews chapter 10 verse 14 that those who have been made perfect are in the process of being made holy sounds very much like Paul's teaching on justification, e.g., Rom. 3:21 5-9, and sanctification, e.g., Rom. 8:1 17. Moreover, both Paul and the author of Hebrews thought of Abraham as the spiritual father of Christians in similar ways. Reasons Paul did not write Hebrews. Despite all this evidence for Pauline authorship, few New Testament scholars today believe Paul wrote it. Both John Calvin and Martin Luther shared this judgment in the 16th century. Even centuries earlier in the 4th century, the Church of Rome did not believe Paul wrote Hebrews, possibly retaining a latent memory of the actual author, Eusebius, Hist. Ecclesiastes L. 3.3.5, 6.20.3. In other words, the rejection of Pauline authorship of Hebrews is a long-standing position in the Church. What can we infer from the book of Hebrews itself? The internal evidence presented by the book of Hebrews itself indicates an author other than Paul. The style of Hebrews, except in the closing verses, 13, 18-25, is quite unlike any other writing of Paul that has survived. In keeping with the style of a person well educated in formal rhetoric, the Greek of Hebrews is highly literary and very ornate. The vocabulary is sophisticated, and it includes 150 words that are not found elsewhere in the New Testament and 10 that do not occur in any other Greek writings that have survived for our study. The structure of the epistle conforms to conventions found in Greek rhetoric used when a speech was designed to persuade its audience to action. Much of this rhetorical achievement is lost when the original Greek of Hebrews is translated into modern language, but it is elegant and euphonious Greek prose in the original. The high rhetorical quality of Hebrews indicates that its author most likely had the most advanced literary education of any of the New Testament writers. The author does not introduce himself as Paul typically did, cf. 2 Cor. 1-1, Gal 1-1, Eph. 1-1, Col 1-1, 1 Tim. 1-1, and 2 Tim. 1-1. Though very compatible with that of the Pauline letters, its theology is very distinctive. The Apostle Paul, for instance, never alludes to Jesus as a priest, which is the principal motif of Hebrews. Hebrews is the only New Testament writing to expound on Jesus as the great high priest and final sacrifice. The most persuasive argument against Pauline authorship, an even more persuasive argument that the Apostle Paul was not the author of Hebrews, is how the author alludes to himself in Hebrews chapter 2 verse 3, stating that the gospel was confirmed to us by those who heard the Lord announce salvation. The Apostle Paul always pointed out that, even though he wasn't one of the 12 original disciples who walked with Jesus during his earthly life, he was nonetheless an apostle of Jesus Christ and usually identified himself as such in his letters. It seems unlikely that Paul here in 2-3 would refer to himself as simply someone who received the gospel from those who had heard the Lord. We've established that someone other than Paul wrote the epistle. But it is possible, even likely, that because of some of the parallels with Paul's epistles, we know the following things about the author. The author was likely a close associate of Paul. The author was able to write in a rhetorically ornate Greek style. The author had become a Christian out of Judaism. The author's understanding of the doctrine of salvation was highly compatible with what the Apostle Paul taught, though creatively distinctive. Connection to Alexandria. Christianity reached Alexandria at a very early date. The missionary impetus of the Christian gospel arose in Jerusalem following the stoning of Stephen when great persecution broke out, and Christians began to scatter, Acts 8. When Acts chapter 6 verse 1 mentions both Hellenistic and Hebraic Jews, the phrase pros to us is used in that context, the exact phrase by which Hebrews is later known. One 20th century scholar named William Manson suggested that Christians who agreed with Stephen brought the Christian message to Alexandria, noting several elements common to Stephen's speech in Acts 7 that is also shared by the book of Hebrews. Its high rhetorical style, its use of the Septuagint, and its possible conceptual constructs. These connections make it very likely that the author was originally from the Alexandrian church, regardless of where he was when he penned the letter and to whom it was initially sent.